وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We were in the مظاهر دنو الهمة, the forms and ways in which low aspiration manifests. We've spoken about 9, and inshallah ta'ala today we're going to go into the 10th bi'idhnillah al-kareem, which is al-inhimaku fi taraf. It is to plunge into luxury. It is overconsumption of luxury things. And this quality of al-inhimaku fi tarafi, plunging yourself into overconsumption of luxury, it busies a person from obeying his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it takes the person, وَيَقُودُهُ إِلَىٰ إِثَارِ الْعَجَلَةِ عَلَىٰ الْآجِلَةِ. And it pushes the person to giving precedence to الْعَاجِلَةِ, that which is going to leave, over that which is going to last. وَيُورِثُهُ ضَعْفَ الْهِمَّةِ. And it inherits the person low aspiration, weak aspiration. And it also taints the person's personality. وَيَنْجَرُّ بِهِ إِلَى الْإِسْتِرْسَالِ فِي الدَّعَةِ. It also drags the person to being consistent upon relaxation, just taking things without no dedication and hard work. Just relax, take it easy, everything enjoy, laugh, play. That's what it does to this person. When a person plunges into luxury, ولذلك the poet he said, فَمَنْ هَجَرَ اللَّذَّاتِ نَالَ الْمُنَى وَمَنْ أَكَبَّ عَلَى اللَّذَّاتِ أَغَضَّ عَلَى الْيَدِ. Anyone who boycotts luxury, he leaves off اللذات, plunging into luxury. نال المنى, that person will reach his goal and what he's looking for. وَمَنْ أَكَبَّ عَلَى اللَّذَّاتِ, anyone who focuses and indulges into عَلَى اللَّذَّاتِ, يعني luxurious, comfortable life, أَغَضَّ عَلَى الْيَدِ, that person will bite their finger out of regret. That's on an individual level, by the way. As for a larger communal scale, then فَإِنَّ التَّرَفَ نَذِيرُ شُؤْمِ اللَّهَ فَوَيُفْقِدُهَا وَيُمَيِّزُهَا وَيُوقِعُهُ فِي التَّخَلُّفِ فِي شَتَى الْمَيَادِينَ وَيَجْعَلُهَا صَيْدًا سَهْلًا لِأَعْدَائِهَا. On a communal level, plunging into luxury, it puts a people or a community backwards. It allows their enemy to go forward, reach civilization before them. It also brings about blames and harm that takes them years, maybe decades, to undo. And there are many ways in which al-inhimaku fi taraf, plunging into luxury and overconsumption of luxury lifestyle, comes about. I'm going to mention some. A. At-tawassu' fi al-ma'akil wal-mashariib, going overboard in eating and drinking. Any smart individual will understand the harm that it has and the evil outcome that eating and drinking excessively has on your religion, on the person's even worldly affairs. It brings about فَهُوَ مِمَّا يُورِثُ الْبَلَادَ. It makes a person weak in his thinking process when a person just overeats and is excessive in eating. And it destroys the person's intellectual, rational mind. It also necessitates from the person being lazy. It also even taints the person's heart. Qaswatul qalb comes from it. It also becomes a means for a person to find the ibadat heavy. It brings about illnesses. And the scholars, they say, فَمَنْ أَكَلَ any individual who eats كَثِيرًا a lot, شَرِبَ كَثِيرًا, the person will drink a lot. فَنَامَ كَثِيرًا, and the person will sleep a lot then. فَخَسِرَ كَثِيرًا, and the person will lose out a lot. Remember that. If you eat a lot, you will drink a lot. And if you drink a lot, you sleep a lot. And when you sleep a lot, you will regret a lot in your life. وَلِذَلِكَ لُقْمَانَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ, he said to his son, يَا بُنَيَّ, my son, إِذَا امْتَلَأَتِ الْمَعِدَّةِ نَامَتِ الْفِكْرَةِ. He said, my son, if you eat a lot and you fill your stomach, your thinking process, your mind will switch off. وَخَرَسَتِ الْحِكْمَةِ, and wisdom perishes. وَقَعَدَتِ الْأَعْضَاءُ عَنِ الْعِبَادَةِ, and the limbs will sit back from doing acts of worship. If a person's stomach becomes full, what will happen is نَامَتِ الْفِكْرَةِ, the person will not think straight. We know that. When we eat a lot, we go, actually, look, I can't think straight. Maybe later, inshallah ta'ala. The person loses wisdom. وَخَرَسَتِ الْحِكْمَةِ, the person becomes mute from any statement of wisdom. The person starts mumbling. وَقَعَدَتِ الْأَعْضَاءُ عَنِ الْعِبَادَةِ, and the body parts, your limbs become weak from doing acts of worship. Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, مَنْ كَثُرَ أَكْلُهُ لَمْ يَجِدْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ لَذَّةِ. Anyone who eats a lot, he will not find in the remembrance of Allah joy. علي رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said, إن كنت بطنا, if you're a person who has a stomach, he said, قعد نفسك زمنا, your soul will suffer from illnesses. يعني زمنا means أي مريضا. If you eat a lot and from there you gain a stomach, what you need to remember is that you're going to suffer from many, many illnesses. وقال بعض الحكماء, some of the wise, they said, أقلل طعاما تحمد مناما. Eat little and you're going to really praise a lot of sleep. يعني you're going to get a lot of sleep from it. That is what you're going to attain and gain from being a person who eats little. If you eat little and you reduce your intake, what will happen is your chances of having a good sleep is very high. Your sleeping will be better. You physically be healthier. And your heart will not suffer from qaswa. You will enjoy the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The joy of Allah's remembrance will be about. You will find it. ولذلك a poet, he said, وَكَمْ مِنْ لُقْبَةٍ مَنَعَتْ أَخَاهَا بِلَذَّةِ سَاعَةٍ أَكَلَاتِ دَهْرٍ وَكَمْ مِنْ طَالِبٍ يَسْعَى لِأَمْرٍ وَفِيهِ هَلَاكُهُ لَوْ كَانَ يَدْرِي. He said, وَكَمْ, how many are being prevented from enjoying a period of time only because of food that they ate? وَكَمْ مِنْ طَالِبٍ, how many people are seeking something and in it is their destruction but they don't know? Another poet, he said, كَمْ دَخَلَتْ أَكْلَةٌ حَشَى شَرِّهِ فَأَخْرَجَتْ رُوحَهُ مِنَ الْجَسَدِ لَا بَارَكَ اللَّهُ فِي طَعَامٍ إِذَا كَانَ هَلَاكُ النُّفُوسِ فِي الْمَعِدِ. And there's no barakah in a food in which in it is your destruction. This is what's going to bring you harm. وَلِذَلِكَ عَلَّامَةُ بْنُ الْقَيِّمِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, he said, وَأَمَّا فُضُولُ الطَّعَامِ going overboard in eating. فَوَدَاعٍ إِلَىٰ أَنْوَاعٍ كَبِيرٍ مِنَ الشَّرِ it is a means, it calls to many harms and many problems. فَإِنَّهُ يُحَرِّكُ الْجَوَارِحَ إِلَىٰ الْمَعَاصِ because what it does is that it pushes the person's limbs to sins. وَيُثْقِلُهَا عَنِ الطَّاعَاتِ and it makes it heavy from the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَحَسْبُكَ بِهَذَيْنِ شَرًّا and those two are enough for you to understand the evil of eating too much. فَكَمْ مِنْ مَعْصِيَةٍ Ibn al-Qayyim said, how many sins have been done? جَلَبَهَا الشِّبَعُ وَفُضُولُ الطَّعَامِ and what brought it about is a full stomach and excessive eating. وَكَمْ مِنْ طَاعَةٍ and how many obedience? How many acts of obedience? حَالَ دُونَهَا what prevented it was because of a person eating too much and filling his stomach. And how many sins were done because of eating too much? And how many acts of obedience were abandoned because a person, he ate too much? فَمَنْ وُقِيَ شَرَّ بَطْنِهِ فَقَدْ وُقِيَ شَرًّا عَظِيمًا Ibn al-Qayyim said, anyone who is prevented from the evil of filling his stomach and eating, then that person has been prevented from many harm. وَالشَّيْطَانُ أَعْظَمُ مَا يَتَحَكَّمُ مِنَ الْإِنسَانِ And the time when shaytan has the most strength over someone and control over someone is إِذَا مَلَأَ بَطْنُهُ مِنَ الطَّعَامِ is when he fills his stomach with food. That is the time shaytan has the most control over you. Until Ibn al-Qayyim said, وَلَوْ لَمْ يَكُنْ If it wasn't, مِنْ امْتِلَاءٍ مِنَ الطَّعَامِ If there wasn't in filling yourself from food, إِلَّا أَنَّهُ يَدْعُو إِلَى الْغَفْلَةِ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَ If eating too much had no other problem and no other harm, except that it will call you to be heedless in the remembrance of Allah, then that is enough for it to be a harm. And that is enough for it to be something very evil. وَإِذَا غَفَلَ الْقَلْبُ And if the heart becomes heedless of the remembrance of Allah, سَاعَةً وَاحِدَةً Just one split minute. What will happen? جَتَمَ عَلَيْهِ الشَّيْطَانِ Shaytan is now taken over. وَوَعَدَهُ وَمَنَاهُ Shaytan, when he takes it over, what would he do? He will make you false promises. He will place in your heart wishful thinking and delusion. He will place in your heart desires, false promises. وَهَامَ بِهِ فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ And he would throw you and drag you through every harm and problem there is. فَإِنَّ النَّفْسَ إِذَا شَبِعَتْ تَحَرَّكَتْ وَجَالَتْ But when the person becomes full, فَإِنَّ النَّفْسَ إِذَا شَبِعَتْ But when the nafs becomes full, you nurture your nafs, it moves. وَجَالَتْ وَطَاقَتْ عَلَىٰ أَبْوَابِ الشَّهَوَاتِ And then it has ability and strength to go to the doors of desires. وَإِذَا جَاعَتْ But when it becomes hungry, you make your nafs feel hungry. What will happen? سَكَنَتْ وَخَشَعَتْ وَذَلَّتْ It humbles itself. It finds tranquility. The nafs doesn't have the ability to do sins. Rather, brothers and sisters, the ones who are going overboard, الَّذِينَ يَتَوَسَّعُونَ فِي الْمَآكِلِ The people who eat too much, لَا يَجِدُونَ لَهَا لَذَّةً كَمَا يَجِدُهَا الْمُقْتَصِدُونَ They don't find as much joy in the eating that the people who are moderate find in the way they deal with food. Just always remember that. The joy that the one who is eating receives is never equal to the one who chose to be moderate in the food the way he feels he is. Allahu Akbar. Ponder on that point. That point is very big. The one who eats, he feels like he finds joy from eating food, right? The joy that he's receiving is nowhere close to the one who is moderate, who's choosing to eat balanced, the joy that he finds. Look what Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said in his Jam'u al-Rasail with the tahqiq of Muhammad Rashad Salim, second volume, page 340. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, فَالَّذِينَ يَقْتَصِدُونَ فِي الْمَآكِلِ The ones who are moderate in their eating, نَعِيمُهُمْ بِهَا أَكْثَرُ مِنَ الْمُسْرِفِينَ فِيهَا the bliss that they have is far greater than the ones who are going overboard in eating. فَإِنَّ أُولَٰئِكَ إِذَا أَدْمَنُوهَا وَأَلْفُوهَا لَا يَبْقَى لَهَا عِنْدَهُمْ كَبِيرُ لَذَّةِ. Because those ones who are overboard in their eating and gave it everything for it, there doesn't remain for them passion and desire for food. مَعَنَّهُمْ قَدْ لَا يَصْبِرُونَ عَنَهَا. Even though they can't be patient without it. وَتَكْثُرُ أَمْرَاضُهُمْ بِسَبَبِهَا. And their illnesses increase because of that. Now Ibn Taymiyyah, what he's saying is that the ones who are moderate in the eating, the blessing that they receive is more than the ones who go overboard. Because the ones who go overboard, because they eat too much, they've kind of destroyed the concept of looking forward to something. And so what happens to them is they lose that ladha. And also, they become weak that they can't be patient without it. So they eat too much. So they're only eating because they feel like they can't be patient without it. Whereas the one who is moderate, he eats because he enjoys it. And it isn't because he is eating because he has control over it. That's where the joy is coming from. And the one who's eating too much now, تَكْثُرُ أَمْرَاضُهُمْ بِسَبَبِهَا. The excessive eating is bringing about so much illnesses for him, which again is causing him another harm. So there's no way a person who eats too much, who whatever comes his way, he eats it, is ever enjoying what he is eating. And as we know, doctors and scientific discoveries have all shown that the biggest harm that the society today, one of the biggest harms that society are suffering from today, is obesity, eating too much. And many illnesses today, many illnesses have been traced back. The source of that illness, the reason for that illness is because of the people eating too much. This is madhhar min madahir dunul himmah. When you only think about what you want to put in your stomach, you have to remember this is what brings about low aspiration. Do you want to achieve something in life? Are you looking to achieve something in life? First of all, start with, or the first thing you need to start with is ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and connect yourself with Allah. Also, what you need to understand is this body that needs to do ibadah needs to be in shape in order to do it. You must get yourself in shape in order to do this. وَلِذَلِكَ. So many people today, they think having a big stomach, it's a ni'mah. Wallahi, it's not. It's a uquba. It was mentioned from the Salaf, some of them, that they saw a person who had a big stomach. And they said, what is this? And he said, ni'mah. And they said, لا والله إنها عقوبة. No, rather, it's a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not a blessing. It's a punishment. وَلِذَلِكَ. Some of the scholars in Islam, they mention that the person's stomach or their stomach should not stick out more than their chin. The person's body should be flat. وَلِذَلِكَ. If you look at the great Sahabas and the noble companions, you tend to find that. So, eating too much, excessively eating, is something that brings about harm. That we need to all work, and including myself, we all need to understand eating, it should be done with moderation, it should be done with discipline, and it's important that we understand we nurture the mind, we nurture the soul, and we also nurture the body. Every day, those three is what we're working on, body, mind, and soul. If we had high aspiration, وَلَوْ أَنَّ نُفُوسَنَا سَمَتْ. If we had high aspiration, وَهِمَمُنَا ارْتَفَعَتْ لَمَحْتَجْنَا إِلَىٰ كَبِيرِ عَنَائِنْ فِي هَذَا الْأَمْرِ. If our nufus, our souls was high, we had high aspiration, lofty aspiration, we wouldn't have wasted our time in so many things today that is being promoted to us. These advertisements, for 30-day program, you lose this much weight, you pay this much money, and this will happen. None of that would a person need. if he just implements one ayah in the Qur'an, ayatun wahida, just one verse, min kitabillahi, from the book of Allah, tughnina an kulli ma mada, it will really suffices from all of the things that I just mentioned, which is, you don't have to go to the gym, wallahi, you don't have to go buy yourself a treadmill or get yourself into a particular program or this or that. And you don't have to pay so much money. Just one ayah, if you implement it, it suffices you from all of that, which is, وَكُلُوا وَشَرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, eat, drink, and don't go overboard. Khalas. One ayah can give you the best results than what any person can prescribe for you. Kulu, eat, washrabu, wala tusrifu. Today, the world that we're living in, they're the ones who advertise all these foods to you. They make it so, oh, eat this, eat this, eat this, and then they say, we'll give you the solution for it. Islam is not like that. Islam doesn't bring a problem and then say, I'll bring a solution for it. Islam prevents the problem from happening or occurring. This is preventing what could lead you to having to go through that depression that you go through because you're overweight, the anxieties that you feel, all of that. Wakulu, eat, washarabu, drink, wala tusrifu, don't go overboard in the two of them. Just eat with moderation. That's it, khalas. Ayah wahida. Walidharika, Tadkiratu Sami' wal Mutakallim by Ibn Jama'ah, he mentions, when it comes to this ayah, he said, قَالَ بَعْضُ الْعُلَمَاءِ, some scholars have said regarding this verse, جَمَعَ اللَّهُ بِهَذِهِ الْكَلِمَاتِ الطِّبَّ كُلَّهُ. In this one verse, which is وَكُلُوا وَشَرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, in this one verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has summarized in this verse all of the meaning of what the word, the concept of medicine, يعني entire underlining reality of medicine is being mentioned in that one verse. وَكُلُوا وَشَرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, eat and drink and don't go overboard. That is the ayah that has summarized the true meaning of الطب. Allahu Akbar. وَلِذَلِكَ, also the Prophet ﷺ, he said in a hadith, Ahmad narrated, and Tirmidhi and Hakim and Albani rahimahullah authenticated it, that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, مَا مَلَأَ دَمِيٌّ وِعَاءً شَرًّا مِّن بَطْنٍ بحسب ابن آدم لقيمات يقيمن صلبه فإن كان لا محالة فثلث لطعامه وثلث لشرابه وثلث لنفسه. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us the best. And if you take the ayah that I just mentioned, which is وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, and you take this hadith and you put it together, wallahi, you don't have to sign up for any gym program. Wallahi, you don't have to be on YouTube and watching this and that. None of that do you need. Just this one ayah and one hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is nothing a human being can fill worse than his stomach. That's the worst thing you can fill up. بِحَسْبِ بِنِ آدَمَ لُقَيْمَاتِ يُقِيمْنَ صُلْبَهُ. Enough. So some people might say, وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, don't go overboard. How do I determine what it means, don't go overboard? We say the Prophet explained it to us, which is enough for you as the child of Adam, from the progeny of Adam. Enough for you is لُقَيْمَاتٌ يُقِيمْنَ صُلْبَهُ. Enough for you is a luqma, a food that you can straighten your back. Because when the person becomes excessively hungry, what happens is that they roll up like a ball. When you get hungry, and you become, the person rolls up and they curve like that. All you need from food is that your back is straight. That's it, khalas. An amount that you can work and you can walk and you do things. فَإِنْ كَانَ لَا مَحَالَ, but if it's necessary, you want to go overboard, you want to eat more, no problem. The Prophet then specifically mentioned to you how, so he's told you the bare minimum, and now he's telling you the maximum you can reach. Beyond that, it's haram, which is فَإِنْ كَانَ لَا مَحَالَ, if you want to eat more than just straighten your back, you want to eat more than that, that's not enough. I'm not just going to eat straight in my back, I want to eat more than that. What is the most you can do? The Prophet then, he said, he's divided the stomach into three. He said, remember this, فَثُلُثُ لِلطَّعَامِهِ, one third is for food. وَثُلُثُ لِشَرَابِهِ, second third is for your what? Is for your drinking. وَثُلُثُ لِنَفْسِهِ, and the last third is what? It is for your breathing. لِنَفْسِهِ, sorry, I keep saying, It's لنفسه. It's for لنفسه, for your breathing, when you breathe. That's what it is. خلاص. It is طعام, شراب, and نفس. If you do not understand that, and you go about eating, and your whole entire stomach, all you do is you make it, all of it for طعام, then remember that this is a person who's now going to cause to himself overconsumption in eating and drinking, which will bring about depression for you. Wallahi, it will. You will suffer anxieties and depression, which many people go through already. And what it also will do is نامت الفكرة. Your thinking will go low. Your body will become weak from ibadat. وما إلى ذلك. All that which we mentioned. ولذلك, a poet, he said, والنفس راغبة إذا رغبتها وإذا ترد إلى قليل تغنع. He said, والنفس راغبة إذا رغبتها. The nafs, it wants something if you place that desire in it. يعني, if the nafs, it just likes something when you convince it, it's good. Do this, yes, it's good. رغبتها. وَإِذَا تُرَدُّ إِلَىٰ قَلِيلٍ تَقْنَعُ. But if something small, you give it, the nafs, that nafs will finally accept it. Okay, you know what? That's all I'm going to get. And this is a statement said by Ibn Abi Dhu'ayb al-Hudali. And al-Asma'i, Abu Bakr Abdul Malik ibn Quraybin, he said about this line of poetry, he said, أَبْرَعُ بَيْتٍ قَالَتُهُ الْعَرَبِ. That this is the most smartest and cleverest and the most wisest statement a poet ever said. Which is that the nafs, راغبة إذا رغبتها, that the nafs wants whatever you teach it. And if you say to the nafs, no, I'm not going to let you eat this food, then it gets happy with the bare minimum. And as another poet said, والنفس كالطفل إن تهمله شبع على حب الرضاع وإن تفطمه ينفطمي. That the nafs is like a child. The child, if the mother, she's breastfeeding the child, for 2 years she breastfeeds. In Islam, the woman, the mother breastfeeds the child for 2 years. As Allah said in the ayah, وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ. So the nafs is like a baby. A baby, the mother breastfeeds the child for 2 years. If she carries on still breastfeeding the child will still accept the breast milk. He won't say no. 5 years, he will still want more. 10 years, he'll still want it. It's upon the mother to, at one point or one stage, to say to the child, this is not going to work now. No breast milk for you anymore. Then and only then will that child stop and taking breast milk. The same applies with the nafs. Someone has to say to the nafs, no, it's not going to work like that. Or the nafs is just going to do istirsal. It's going to carry on and on and on and eat more and more and say, yesterday I had one burger, can I have two burgers today? The nafs will start demanding things. And it will reach a point where the person has no control over the nafs. The nafs has control over you. It's controlling you. You're now eating because your body's demanding for it. Just give it to me, I want it. Another poet, he said, نَفْسُ إِذَا أَعْطَيْتَهَا مُنَاهَا فَارِغَةٌ نَحْوَ هَوَاهَا فَاهَا. That the nafs, if you give it what it wants, that's it. It wants more, desires it, enjoys it. And it will then probably desire something else. And another, another thing. And then another thing. And then let me try this. And then let me try this. The poet also said, إِذَا الْمَرْءُ أَعْطَى نَفْسَهُ كُلَّ مَشْتَهَدْ وَلَمْ يَنْهَاهَا تَاقَتْ إِلَى كُلِّ مَطْلَبِي. If the person gives the nafs everything it desires, and he doesn't stop the nafs from it, taqat ila kulli matlabi, the nafs will start wanting everything out there. I'm going to stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdi, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.